Good morning. May it please the court, my name is Pam Critchfield for the state of California. There are two issues in this case, whether petitioner's ineffective assistance claim is precluded by the rule, the Supreme Court's rule in Tollett v. Henderson, and if not, whether defense counsel rendered ineffective assistance by failing to file a motion to suppress the evidence. As to the first claim, the magistrate judge ignored long-standing Supreme Court precedent and numerous decisions of this court to find that petitioner's ineffective assistance claim was cognizable. The Supreme Court has made a policy decision that guilty pleas represent a break in the chain of the events that preceded it.
I think that's true for everything except ineffective assistance of counsel that might have wrongfully induced someone to take a guilty plea because counsel did not properly advise the client as to whether or not he ought to take the plea.
And I think the Supreme Court has addressed that question in McMahon v. Richardson, which was an ineffective assistance claim or a claim that counsel failed to advise about suppressing a motion or a confession to plea. And I think that this court has held that ineffective assistance claims pre-plea are barred by Tollett.
What's your strongest support for that? The notion that there is a categorical bar. So if we can play with the facts, but if a hypothetical
okay.
includes...
I think there's several cases.
Well, counsel, so to be clear, if the hypothetical that we're going to talk about is a situation where the issue had been raised and defendant was aware of, as in this case, he's indicated that he was aware pre-plea of the possibility of bringing a motion. I put that in a very different category. If we had a hypothetical case where there was no indication, where no indication that the possibility of a very meritorious motion had never even been discussed, would you still take the position?
Yes, I would. We would.
Okay, and what's your strongest support for that, please?
It would be Tollett itself. It would be McMahon versus Richardson.
But Tollett talks about, right, it allows for IAC where the waiver wasn't knowing.
Exactly. There is an IAC claim, I agree, as to advice about the plea itself.
Uh-huh.
And advice about the plea itself would be, for example, minimum and maximum sentence. Misadvice about whether a Romero motion is a motion to strike a prior. Advice about the parole, your parole eligibility.
What's the difference between those cases and one in which whether you would be guilty depends on a suppression motion?
The suppression motion doesn't bear on the validity of the plea. The defendant here or petitioner here has to assume.
But does the counsel have an obligation to advise about what the likelihood of success at trial would be or not? And doesn't that affect the plea? I don't really understand. I mean, I guess there's some logic to what you're saying, but I'm not sure any case says what you're saying.
Well, in McMahon v. Richardson, the Supreme Court said that at most that petitioner's claim is really that his counsel mistakenly assessed the admissibility of the evidence.
But counsel, are you going about this the hard way? It seems to me in the hypothetical we're talking about, you know, where there really isn't, or the one perhaps Judge Freeland's talking about where we have really egregious IAC, there's something to debate about. But in this case, at ER 77, I read this as saying, while both of the public defenders indicated they really couldn't remember discussing the possibility of this motion, that the defendant was raising it, saying, hey, I don't think this was a correct search. So if he had taken that position pre-plea and then chosen to go forward and enter a plea, doesn't that take this outside of the...
He did.
Right, that's my point. And so...
Exactly. So you're looking at it from, was the potential motion potentially successful or not?
No, I'm not. What I'm saying is that it's quite different if somebody, under Tollett, we have to find knowing and voluntary waiver, right? That is the question we would have to grapple with. And I think I agree with Judge Friedland. There could be an effective assistance of counsel where we'd really have a very difficult case to decide whether a plea was really knowing and voluntary such that habeas should be foreclosed. I think Tollett allows for that. I'll just tell you that's my reading of Tollett.
Okay.
But situation, this particular case, the defendant isn't claiming to have been surprised or unaware of the possibility of raising such a motion. In fact, he's the one raised it to defense counsel. So why do we have to take on this much harder question, the much harder legal question of whether Tolla would ever allow this?
Well, you don't in this case. If you agree that the magistrate judge failed to apply deference to the decision of the California State Court in the ineffective assistance claim.
Not a trick question. Thank you.
Yeah, well, but it seems to me, to come back to the Tolla question, it seems to me actually fairly well established law. And you answered that McMahon is overruled, or at least limited Tolla, but I just reread McMahon, and I don't see Justice White saying that at all. It seems to me that even if ineffective assistance of counsel has the consequence of the defendant in the state court pleading when a competent counsel would have told him a lot of things and said you shouldn't plead, I think Tolla leaves that open, which then leads us to, well, was there ineffective assistance of counsel in this case? Now, you may win on this case on the ground that the state court said, well, no, there's some, at least we can infer from the decision of the state court, I'd say it that way, because we don't get much out of the state court.
Silent denial.
Yeah. But we can infer that, well, maybe this was at least in the judgment of a not incompetent counsel, they would, the motion might have failed because of possibility of argument of exigent circumstances, and whether I agree with that judgment by the court or not, I have to leave it alone if it's not unreasonable. So you may win, but I'm not sure you'll win on Tolla.
Well, I think if you read McMahon, it also says that waiving trial and making a plea entails the inherent risk that good faith evaluations of reasonably competent attorney will turn out to be mistaken.
Yes, reasonably competent attorney.
And so you're asking me about a situation that frankly don't have here, in our view, where...
Well, the question is whether this was ineffective assistance of counsel.
Absolutely not.
And if it's not ineffective assistance of counsel, you win. But I think if it were ineffective assistance of counsel, such as directly involuntary, you would lose.
When you said absolutely not, were you responding, absolutely not, this is not ineffective assistance of counsel, or were you responding, no, that's not the question?
I was responding, absolutely not. This is not ineffective assistance.
Thanks for the clarification. No, I just want to
make sure. It seems like McMahon wouldn't have talked about whether it was reasonably competent if that didn't matter, because you could never bring a habeas claim like this. So I think this idea that you can't bring this kind of claim is not getting traction. So maybe we should talk about why you think this suppression motion would have lost anyway.
Okay. There are many reasons that I think the magistrate judge sat in the shoes of a superior court judge and decided that he would have denied, or he would have granted this motion.
If you don't mind, my guess is he stood in the shoes.
I'm sorry, he stood in the shoes. That's what I meant to say. He stood in the shoes of the magistrate judge and decided that he didn't apply any deference at all. He didn't apply the Strickland deference to the public defender's decision. He didn't apply the deference to the California courts when it denied the ineffective assistance claim. I think there were two. On the record we have, there was no hearing, so we have the incident report at ER 82. I think the facts in that incident report clearly show that there were two different reasons the police could have entered that room, either under the emergency aid doctrine because they thought someone was in there needing assistance, and they say that in the record, or under the protective sweep doctrine. I think, and in fact, to elaborate on what you said, Judge, that the habeas counsel did contact both attorneys, both public defenders, in the first public defender said initially, I don't remember talking to my client about the possibility of bringing the motion, but then called back and said, actually, I pulled the file. I told him it wouldn't have. I didn't believe it would succeed on these.
Right, so it seems to me that's the Strickland problem, right? It seems to me that there was a decision made, a conversation had. It's not that the defendant wasn't aware of it, but that there was a tactical or a strategic decision not to bring the motion, which takes, I think, this case, it really takes it out of the ballpark, if you will.
Of that's the Tala issue. Okay.
We'll hear from the other side.
Yes.
Well, at least you know what you need to respond to.
I have a pretty good idea, Your Honor. And may it please the Court, Paul Clavin on behalf of the petitioner, Gregory Mahrt. Let me start by saying that I believe that McMahon does leave open the possibility of proceeding on habeas even when there is a plea. The question is whether the advice that led to the decision to accept the plea was within the standards of Strickland. If it's not, then there's no break in the chain, because the plea itself was not made voluntarily and intelligently. And in this case, and same thing in Tollett, and same thing in the more recent Primo case, the courts look at whether the advice and the information that was provided to the client was within the realm of competence or not. If it was not, then the plea was not knowingly and intelligently made. And to focus on the change in the testimony of the first attorney, Mr. Thomas, initially, of course, he said he didn't recall discussing this at all, and then he called back and said, well, I looked at it, and said that the search was justified. That's outside of the realm of normal competence. That was based on what the attorney was aware of.
Why isn't there strategic calls? When I think if we were allowed to second guess, if you're allowed to second guess, you might make a different decision. But why is it outside the realm of competence? I mean, you know what the opposing parties argued. It was a domestic violence call. There was a concern about a gun. He met them well outside this room, to be sure, but there's concern that, you know, maybe she really was in there. So what's your best argument?
One, Your Honor, it was not a domestic violence call. There was a call about a man and woman arguing over a gun.
I saw that in your briefing. What is that? That sounds pretty domestic violence-y to me. I mean, isn't that sort of a classic? They didn't use maybe the word domestic violence or that phrase, but man and woman arguing over a gun, that's got to be every responding police officer's worst nightmare and scary.
Well,
dangerous.
Excuse me, Your Honor, but in the cases where the Ninth Circuit has talked about the domestic violence situation, the call itself has included information about domestic violence. Somebody has been beaten up. Somebody has been assaulted. There are threats.
We're going to be very concerned about second-guessing police officers when their safety is at issue. You know that. When their safety is at issue, there's a gun involved in a domestic situation. And so I'm not sure this is going to be fruitful for you. Do you have another argument that we can focus on?
Well, Your Honor, the call, the only indication given in the report was that the deputies decided they were going to do a protective sweep. If the attorney is advising counsel, that's absolutely justified. That's clearly contrary to controlling United States Supreme Court.
Can you tell us on the record how far away the room was from where your client was when he went out to police the officers, what the distance was, and can we tell whether or not I'm going to call her a mother-in-law, although I recognize there wasn't a marriage there, but the owner of the property.
That's right.
Who apparently said her daughter had left.
That's right.
Do we have, what can you tell me about those two facts? Because that seems to change things for me.
Well, it was a fairly large piece of property. We don't have, I don't think, the exact dimensions, but he was out by the front gate when he met the deputies. He wasn't standing near the property or right outside, as some of the Ninth Circuit cases.
It's hard to know that, though, because this is a converted garage, so I can't tell how far away the gate was from the premises that he's calling his residence.
Right. It was a substantial distance away, Your Honor. I don't have the exact numbers, but they were not one on top of the other. It was more of a compound-type area than just a standard residential house. So the deputies are saying they conduct a protective sweep under Maryland v. Bowie. Protective sweep is only authorized when you have an in-home arrest, and there's no indication. And
I'm more concerned about this being emergency situation, not protective sweep in the sense of protecting officer safety, but protecting the woman who was the subject of the report. We know that your client said she's not here. Do we also know that her mother said she's not here to the police? So the police heard from both that she's not here.
Declaration to that effect in the petition. So both, and admittedly, if it was just my client. There is some question, but the other person's mother is also saying she's gone, she's not here. So the police arrive, and again, if we're turning to the emergency or aid situation, again, that wasn't in the sheriff's report. They didn't indicate that, and that wasn't raised by the prosecution below. That was something that the magistrate judge on his own in trying to performing his function under EPA came up with, and he looked at that. And under the cases, both the Brigham City case and the Fisher case, there needs to be a lot more before officers are allowed to breach the sanctity of a home.
I'm a police officer, and I'm responding to a report that says there's a man and a woman arguing over a gun. I come out to the property, and there's a man who says she's gone, and there's a woman who says she's gone, and I say, okay, I guess nothing to see here, I'm leaving. If I'm the officer superior, I'm going to say, and what if she was in there and the two of them were lying and she's dead now? It's on you. I think a cautious police officer, having heard the report, man and woman arguing about a gun, man saying she's gone, woman saying she's gone, well, maybe she's not.
Your Honor, we are we're agreeing that they could detain Mr. Mahrt. We're not complaining about the detention, the initial detention that took place. The officers are allowed to continue to investigate and determine exactly what happened.
But how can they do that to their own satisfaction, to the removal of any possible danger to the woman about whom they really know nothing except that there was a report and these two people say that she's gone? They can question him until the cows come home.
Oh, but again, they've got the mother right there also, who is a neutral person who they could talk to satisfy themselves.
That was a central question, I'm afraid, for us, which makes it, of course, one more layer difficult for you, is we've got to determine that the Superior Court judge was unreasonable in deciding that the emergency doctrine doesn't apply, or like it's even worse than that. We've got to make up reasons that the Superior Court judge could have had.
Right.
Which makes it very difficult for you, Mike. I'm sympathetic to your side of the case, but why this was tough, given the EPA standards.
Right, but on the other hand, Your Honor, the case law is pretty tough also. And if you look at the cases, and again, we're not arguing, as the Attorney General says, that you need ironclad proof of somebody in there. But you need something. And the Brigham City case, they've got an actual observation when the officers arrive of a loud party fighting, what's termed a fracas. They see somebody hitting someone else, spitting blood out in the sink. Court said, under those circumstances, they can go inside. Fisher, the same thing, discussion about a man going crazy. And that they can hear things going on. They see blood on the door, on a truck, all over the place. And under those circumstances, they are allowed to go in. But there's no controlling Supreme Court precedent that would allow the emergency aid doctrine to be applied in this case. In a case like this, where, again, you have the call, call is about a gun, but again, Florida versus JL, there's no automatic firearm exception to the Fourth Amendment. They have that call, the officers arrive, they see Mr. Mahrt, there's no indication of struggle, there's no blood, there's no fracas, there's no violence, there's no yelling, there's no nothing going on that is comparable in any way to what the court is looking at in either Fisher or the Brigham City case. So under those circumstances, again, we're not allowed to extrapolate into what some other court would have held, except that we have to determine that this court was unreasonable. But in terms of controlling Supreme Court precedent, you don't have any reduction of the standard. And again, the court has consistently talked about the sanctity of the home and the absolute need to have a warrant before you enter it, unless it falls within one of these specific categories. So terms of the advice that my client received, assuming that Mr. Thomas told him that, and of course we do dispute that because he said we don't have any. My client says that he didn't say that, and we do put in the sheet that Mr. Thomas filled out, which is blank except for the client's name. I mean, there wasn't a lot of effort. If you look through, based on what my client says, and
I understand that pretty much any competent counsel in this circumstance would have made a suppression motion. I mean, it's his only hope. Listen, if it's a little lower, she said it's him, so winning it's his only hope.
Right. Well, and Your Honor, it jumps out at you because if it's just a protective sweep, it's clearly not a protective sweep. Any competent defense lawyer would look at that and say, you know, this is contrary to Maryland versus Bowie. We will file a motion. It certainly is not automatically futile. And so in terms of the competence, they were incompetent. Whether Mr. Mahrt mentioned it to them or whether it was just something that they, in their due diligence.
I'm not sure how much importance I attach to the police officers labeling it of a protective sweep when, you know, it would require them to know a fair amount of law, but if they're allowed to do it under one doctrine, say emergency circumstances, and they need the wrong doctrine, yeah.
Granted, Your Honor, still, an attorney look at this would think, well, it's not a protective sweep under Maryland versus Bowie, but also it doesn't rise to the level of emergency aid under the Brigham City and the Fisher cases because those require either something else going on in terms of the tip or
what is the line of my problem with the city is
it's a tough standard, Your Honor. In this case, I think no reasonable court looking at this should have denied the motion to suppress under the controlling precedents. They are going contrary to what the Supreme Court has said if they decided to let this in, let this evidence in.
Is there anything in the record that tells us whether the officers knew for sure that your client and the mother were the only people at that residence at that point?
All we have is the report, unfortunately, Your Honor. Again, there's no evidentiary hearing to expand that by actually questioning the officers. So in the report, there is no indication that in fact they knew that. They didn't admit to that one way or the other.
Didn't Robin Ryan, the owner, provide a declaration that says that she?
Oh, yes, absolutely. From our I understood the question was whether the officers acknowledged that. The officers did not acknowledge that. The evidence shows that, in fact, Mr. Mahrt indicated that the other person, that the woman had gone, and the mother also provided a declaration.
Right, and I'm looking for that. It's CR 95, I think, or 93, my notes are. Sometimes I can't read my own handwriting, but I'm trying to figure out what point in the sequence she told them that. I just want to remind myself, when did she say she told them that?
It is ER 95, Your Honor, and it just says she was present when the deputies arrived at 10 p.m. to investigate a report regarding Petitioner Gregory Mahrt and my daughter Tracy Ryan. I confirmed that Petitioner and my daughter had been arguing, but advised the deputies that Tracy had left the area prior to their arrival. This occurred prior to any search of Mahrt's room by the deputies.
That doesn't necessarily preclude there being other people, though, right? I mean, so Tracy is gone. The officers were told that, but they don't know that there isn't some other woman in the house or some other person who had the gun, or they don't know anything about anyone else, right?
Or child
or anything.
No, but there's no indication that they had no reason to think that anybody else was injured or in need of assistance in that room. The report was just about the man and the woman arguing. The discussion and the information given to the deputies at the time was that the woman who was involved in the argument is no longer on the premises. So if that gets into fairly speculative police work, then to do that, and that definitely is contrary to Brigham City and
address the deputies. Two important facts that I think were not mentioned is, first of all, the call was from a neighbor, an identified person. Second of all, Mr. Mahrt came out, and it isn't clear how far away the gate was from the garage. He was uncooperative. He wouldn't answer questions, except to say that
she
left.
Right, he answered some. He gave up that much information.
He said that his girlfriend had left, and that was all. And the police are not, they're not bound to believe that. And I think there's case law that says, many cases that say, the defendant said, oh, no, she's not there anymore, and they go in anyway, and the court has held that reasonable. And the touchstone of this is reasonableness. And this is what Fisher says. This is what People v. Troyer says.
It would be an easier case for you if only the male said she's not here, but the mother comes.
The mother is not mentioned in the police incident report.
Yeah, but we've got affidavits.
You have an affidavit, but she's not mentioned here at all. And then one other thing is in this police incident report is they say, based on his behavior, I felt he may be attempting to conceal the victim inside. So they aren't just relying on a protective sweep, and even if that was the only word in there, it wouldn't matter.
Does it matter that the mother isn't mentioned in the police report? Are you suggesting the affidavit's not true? I'm not sure what you mean by that.
Just that they don't mention it in the police report.
That would seem to me to cut against you because they've got an incomplete police report that justifies the search more than it was in fact justified.
But the bottom line is they do not have to believe either under these circumstances, either the defendant or the mother.
I've reread the declarations, and it's not quite stated that the mother identifies herself as the mother. It's stated that I told them that my daughter was gone. Now, I'm not sure how much difference it makes if somebody comes and says it's my daughter and she's gone, or if it's an unidentified woman who says she's gone. But we at least know that we have two people.
Became more uncooperative as they walked toward the garage, which I think alerted them even more. So I'll submit it on the briefs.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much to both sides for your arguments. Mark versus Beard, you're saying